Welcome to the audiobook of Crypto, the Disruptor, the Rise of Money from Barter to Bitcoin. Written by Mukesh Jindal, narrated by Anuj. Chapter 1. The Rise of Riches. Money is the most universal and most efficient system of mutual trust ever devised, says Yuval Noah Harari. The evolution of money. To know what money is and where it is going, you should first know the story of money. The ability to communicate and exchange are the two significant attributes that distinguish humans from other animals and allow us to roam planet Earth as the dominant species. Unfortunately, evidence of the means of value exchange employed during the primitive hunter-gatherer days is scarce. Our primitive forefathers lived for today, as the future was always uncertain. They did not save. They hunted and feasted when they wished to or felt hungry. During a shortage of prey, food, or other necessities, they raided other tribes and stole their possessions. During those uncivilized, brutish days, it is unlikely that humans would have exchanged one good for another in a civilized manner. Trading and value exchange became more organized and widespread after the emergence of civilizations around 10,000 years ago during the Neolithic Revolution or the New Stone Age. But the story of money begins much earlier. The first forms of money were not coins or notes, but commodity money, goods that had value in themselves as well as value in exchange. Some examples of commodity money are cattle, cowrie shells, grains, salt, and precious metals. Humans began to use commodity money as early as the Paleolithic era or the Old Stone Age. However, the use of commodity money became more widespread and organized during the Bronze Age, when civilizations such as the Mesopotamians, Egyptians, and Chinese used items such as cattle, grain, shells, and metals as mediums of exchange. Early evidence shows that the barter system, an ancient method of trading goods and services without using money, existed before, alongside the use of commodity money. You give me a knife, I give you an apple. Sort of value exchanges were rooted in a give-and-take policy. It was the Phoenicians, an ancient civilization from the eastern Mediterranean region, who took the barter system across oceans. Numerous civilizations throughout history have used the barter system, including the Egyptians, Mesopotamians, Babylonians, Greeks, Romans, and Chinese. The Babylonians improved the bartering system during the Bronze Age, which lasted from around 3000 BCE to 1200 BCE. By creating common goods that were exchanged for food, tea, spices, and weapons. Human skulls and salt were some of the popular items used as the medium of exchange. During the Middle Ages, Europeans traveled around the world to barter furs and other goods such as food items, weapons, and jewelry in exchange for silk and perfumes. Colonial Americans used deerskins, musket balls, and wheat as common goods for bartering. Even a highly developed civilization like the Inca Empire, which was based in present-day Peru, was a moneyless bartering society until 1524, when Francisco Pizarro González, a Spanish conqueror, set foot on their land. The mountain that devoured men. Pizarro was one of the first Europeans to cross the Pacific in pursuit of his fortune in the early 16th century. He was after gold and silver. The Incas believed gold to be the sweat of the sun and silver to be the tears of the moon. They appreciated the aesthetic value of both precious metals, but they couldn't fathom Pizarro's insatiable lust for gold and silver. Despite a few failed attempts, Pizarro carried out a successful plunder of Peru with Spanish royal approval in 1530. He looted around 6,000 kilograms of pure 22-carat gold and nearly 12 tons of silver. Pizarro died in Lima in 1541, but his legacy lived on. The Spanish Empire sponsored more expeditions to the Americas or the New World to bring home tons of gold and silver. It is important to note here that North America and South America together are popularly known as the New World, since the Europeans discovered these lands much later and these are relatively new civilizations. But the real treasure was on top of a mountain that stands tall at 15,827 feet above sea level in the Andes Mountains near the Bolivian city of Potosi. The economic history of the world took a dramatic turn when an indigenous Andean named Diego Gualpa discovered traces of silver on Cerro Rico in 1545. Cerro Rico, which means rich mountain in Spanish, is an apt name for this beautiful mountain with vast deposits of silver ore. Initially, the Spanish conquistadors paid the villagers to work in the silver mines of Cerro Rico. But from the late 16th century onwards, they had to introduce forced labor, also known as mita, as the environmental conditions in the mines were so harsh that no one was willing to work in them. Under the mita system, men aged between 18 and 50 were forced to work for 17 weeks a year, owing to the constant exposure to the mercury fumes generated by the patio process of silver refinement. Mortality among the miners soared to new heights. The workers also had to climb up and down through the 700-foot mine shaft, which was filled with toxic air. Hundreds were also killed and wounded by falling rocks. Potosi became a silver rush city with a ruthless face. Domingo de Santo Tomas, a legendary Spanish Dominican missionary, called Potosi a mouth of hell into which a great mass of people enters every year and are sacrificed by the greed of the Spaniards to their god. Rodrigo de Loaiza, a Spanish priest, called the silver mines infernal pits. He also noted that if 20 healthy Indians enter on Monday, half may emerge crippled on Saturday. In 1638, an Augustinian monk, Fray Antonio de la Calancha, wrote, "Every peso coin minted in Potosi has cost the lives of 10 Indians who have died in the depths of the mines." As the population of the indigenous workers had dropped due to the inhumane working conditions, thousands of African slaves were imported to serve as human mules. Even today, the devilish nature of the mine shafts and tunnels of the Cerro Rico remains. On the mountain of death of Cerro Rico, Spain found its fortune. The mountain gave 45,000 tons of pure silver to the Spaniards between 1556 and 1783. This silver was turned into bars and coins and mints and then shipped to Spain. Potosi rapidly turned into one of the major cities of the Spanish Empire, with a population of nearly 2 lakh at its zenith, a larger population than most European cities at that time. Valor en Potosi, meaning to be worth a Potosi, is still a Spanish expression that means to be worth a fortune. Pizarro's conquest of the New World had made the Spanish Empire rich beyond its wildest imagination. The Incas, however, could not understand what the Europeans were doing with all the loads of gold and silver they had shipped from their land. It was said that even if all the snow in the Andes turned to gold, still Europeans would not be satisfied. The Incas failed to understand that silver was more than a shiny, beautiful metal for Pizarro and his men. It could easily be turned into money, a unit of account, a store of value, and more than anything else, a portable power. Coinage. Money is a medium of exchange that can eliminate the inefficiencies of the barter system. It is a unit of account that facilitates valuation and calculation, and a store of value that allows longer-term economic transactions which can cross geographical boundaries. Money must be affordable, available, durable, reliable, fungible, meaning mutually interchangeable, and portable to perform all these functions optimally. Precious metals such as gold, silver, and bronze.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.